sir, they will join, maybe.
Yes, sir. Let them join later. We will start.
Okay. Otherwise, sir, also wait.
Okay, sir. So, very good afternoon and welcome back to all of you. I am Anand Kumbhar from Sanjay Godhout University. I welcome you all for second session. Our today's second session topic is design of MPPT controller solar panel with grid tied inverters using MATLAB Simulink. For this session, we have today's resource person, M. Malayappan sir from Pantech Group of Company. Let me give a small introduction. He has completed his graduation from Government College of Engineering, Bargur, completed his post-graduation from College of Engineering, Guindy, Anna University, Chennai. And currently he is working as senior R&D engineer at Pantech Group of Company. He has handled and successfully completed various projects such as MATLAB Integrated Power Electronics Development Application Project for Texas Instruments. Also, he completed successfully the open source 5 kilowatt solar power system with thin film solar PV panel in Government College of Technology, Coimbatore. He was also involved in DC smart home project development in Coimbatore Institute of Technology. He also successfully installed open source 6 kilowatt solar power system for non-linear loads in the Coimbatore Institute of Technology, Coimbatore. He also completed on vector control of three-phase induction motor. With this brief introduction, I welcome you, sir, on behalf of Sanjay Godhout University Electrical Engineering Department, on behalf of all participants, and on my personal behalf, I welcome you, sir, and I request you take the charge of session and please start the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Rajan Lenis, sir. I personally thank you all for giving me the opportunity for this wonderful occasions, and I welcome all the participants to this session. First of all, I would like to confirm that is my audio and video is comfortable to you?
Yeah.
Anyone, yes, sir. Can you please?
Comfortable.
Okay, right. Is my screen is viewable, sir? Now I didn't share my screen, but my camera is okay. My camera is working perfectly.
It is working.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. Able to see. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your confirmation. So let us start the topic. I am going to present my presentations.
Sir, are you sharing the screen?
Yes, I am sharing my screen.
Okay.
Yeah, can you able to watch my screen presentation?
Yes, sir. Yes.
It is visible.
Oh, okay, great. Thanks for your confirmation, sir. Today's topic is design of MPPT controller and a grid tie inverter using the MATLAB Simulink. In this session, we are going to discuss in detail how the components are designed and how we can model this circuits in the MATLAB Simulink and all. And in addition to that, I will give you some bonus content which is not listed in this today agenda, but it will be more useful to you, those who are all participating in this webinar. And I am Malayappan from Pantech, so group of company. Generally, the Pantech involves manufacturing of educational lab equipment, so which is that development boards called the microcontroller, DSP, FPGA, So these kind of development boards we generally manufacture. Similarly, we do solutions for motor control applications. Like any kind of motors, we can give you the complete solutions like a prototyping or and experimental basis. That is the teaching kits. And second, our main activity is that do it yourself activity. So which is that see, actually generally Pantech is insisting you like you are as a you may be a faculty or research scholar or a student or any hobbyist persons, you may be anything, but our main intention is to do your project yourself. So just take your resources from anywhere in the world, then build your own project, build your shape your thoughts in real time manner. So motor. So don't walk to any project centers or companies for your research activity. So you just develop your research activity and then create your own project. So then only in next 2 to 3 years or next 5 years in India, many design engineer or many research scientists may create. So we are insisting all wherever we go, we are just insisting these points. You just create your own project yourself. And next activity, our big activity is that training, a technical training activity. So in this, we are conducting some kind of like challenges, like a 30 days challenge, 15 days challenge, 5 days challenge. See, actually, in this one, we will share you some challenged topics. So we will share in easy manner, like how organized content will be shared via digital medium. And based on that video, you have to develop, you have to finish that particular challenge. So everything related to that, if you are electrical engineer, then the entire challenge will be towards the electrical engineering. Similarly, if you are being an electronics or computer science engineer, then the challenge will be towards that, like that. So these three are the major activity. So you can get a benefit, you can get a support from the Pantech. And we have a physical company, all over South India, like Chennai, Hyderabad, Vijayawada, and Tiruchi, Madurai, Coimbatore. And sometimes back we had a branch in Pune, but due to pandemic we closed that office after the Pune after the corona. And in addition to that, you can get a special kind of sensors, whatever required for your research activity, you can get a special kind of sensors, like any special sensors like current sensors for your specific applications. Like I want to measure a DC current with the 10 ampere, DC current with the 20 ampere, and AC current for some so on so range. So like that, if you give me your requirement, then I will give you the solutions called like development modules, sensor modules you can get from the Pantech. And so whatever, these are all the technicals, again the same content will be available in your textbook or in your email. A bunch of will reach you from many resources. But suppose if you want to be a successful engineer or successful person in your life, follow some protocols. The protocols nothing but so there are some certain step. See, suppose if you want to finish a 30 days challenge, or if you want to finish your research activity within a 6 months, or within a 3 months, or within a year, or within a 2 year or 3 year, whatever it may be. So we should personally, we should have some protocols. Like the psychologist, the world famous psychologist Earl Nightingale, given some 20 minutes video. So it is available in the YouTube. You just listen this video, then definitely it will give you a big eye opening to your further proceeding steps. Called, suppose if you are doing so and so work from morning to evening, but after this video, if you listen this video, then after this video, definitely your movement or your activity will be different at any point of time. I will share you that video just beyond the line. I will open the thing. In YouTube, you should search Earl Nightingale with the pancake. Are you getting my video? Are you? Anyone?
No,
can you?
Okay. No, sir.
Okay. Just a second. I'm sharing.
Sharing it to chat box?
No. So I will share in the main screen itself. Okay. I will. This screen is not perfectly sharing. So I will give you the link in the chat box. You please just check it. It will give you, definitely it will help you in your personal life, definitely. Yeah, I shared the link. You please just check the link parallelly. Just open your chat and then check it. So he has given some nice tips, what you have to do, what you should not do. And so this is a common protocol for everyone. So like you may be any person, but suppose if you follow this common protocol, then definitely it will help you to become an achiever, not listen the concept and then just walk out from the room. It's not like that. So if you want to be a doer, then you have to follow the entire steps. I am listening this video on daily basis. So daily, whenever I wake from the bed, then immediately my first job is that listen this video. So I personally suggest you all to get a benefit from this video. And let us move to the next slide. So that, now my presentation is people can watch. So my the today content is first we can discuss about the introductions, and second concept is what is the renewable energy. Actually here I'm given two introductions. So it's a renewable energy, and how in this research activity, and how we can implement in the how we can focus our on this particular domain, like solar PV systems. And suppose in our entire work, if you develop a converter or boost converter or any inverter or whatever it may be, so we should know the basic fundamentals of how to choose the components. Called, suppose if it is a MOSFET or IGBT, then why we are choosing that particular MOSFET, and how the inductance or capacitance can be chosen, how it can be calculated. So everything we can discuss in this session. And let us talk about renewable energy. So the renewable energy is nowadays actually it's an unavoidable topic for being an electrical engineer. So you should, you must know about these basics of technology. So in this one today, so what is a solar PV system? How this generally classified? See, in the solar PV system, these are all the basic components called. So there will be a sunlight is required. So it's a renewable sources. So we are trying to use that. And from this sunlight, we are receiving the sunlight via the solar PV panel. So which is the array number of cells connected together, and then we are getting a solar PV module. So this is this energy is stored in the battery via some converters, or like it may be any type of converter. So it's going to give the it's going to charge the battery on a smooth manner. Like voltage must be whatever it may be, the sunlight. Depends the sunlight, the panel will give you a random parameter. So from this random parameter, we have to regulate the random parameter, then only we can increase the battery life. Because inside the battery, only the chemicals are going to be there. So if you pour the energy on the random ways, then the dynamics of the chemical may get heavily affected. So to regulate that dynamics of the chemical only, we are trying to feed the power on somehow improved manner. So for that we have to keep on a controller. That control will monitor the battery input and output voltages. And similarly, once if you charge the battery, from the charged battery, we are going to use feed the power to the load via some again converter. So that converter will take care about load parameters. Like suppose if it is a 230 voltage load, the converter will convert from whatever the input, that it will gives you the 230 voltage AC with the 50 hertz. So that is a desired parameters rating. So this inverter will take care about entire our things, right? So this is general solar PV system. So in this solar PV system, nowadays again they have introduced two more concepts. So one is called AC solar PV system, and again second concept is the DC microgrid PV system. Because of gadgets development in that market, so they have introduced a second topic called DC microgrid PV system. So nowadays the modern building, modern household applications, everything has converted to that smart loads. Like if you take a fan, it's a smart fan. If you take a fridge, it's a smart fridge. If you take a AC, then it's a smart AC. So whatever it may be, everything, all new type of motors or new type of loads has been replaced with the conventional, that is earlier 10 years old, 20 years old technology has been replaced with the latest loads. See, in that point, all the loads are working under AC only. But unnecessarily, we are converting from AC, we are keeping one controller to activate in controller inside the any gadgets. Like if it is a washing machine, then we have to keep one converter to feed the power. If generally nowadays the washing machines comes with a BLDC machine. So for activating the BLDC machine, we have to keep one controller. So that controller will take care about that required power supply for the BLDC machine. But we will apply 230 voltage. So in this point, again, that DC microgrid PV system is developed. So let us take a AC solar PV system. So in this AC solar PV system, so we will receive energy from the sunlight. And that is stored in the battery, or directly we can feed to the inverter. So it may be a grid inverter or off grid inverter, whatever it may be. So finally, we are going to activate AC type of load, right? And if you use a battery and you are directly connected to the load via the inverter, then it is off grid inverter. And suppose if you integrate, if you interact your inverter with the grid, then it is called a grid tie inverter. So in that case, why we should use grid integration? Suppose if you have excessive power, then we should export the power to the grid. So then we can get we can extract maximum power from the panel, right? So for that purpose only, we need a grid integration facility. So how we can integrate the grid? So what is the key parameter to monitor or to identify from the grid? So anyone, can you, if you have idea, please share in the chat box. So what is meter to monitor inverter to the grid tie inverter? And next one, this is the DC grid solar PV system. So again, the same thing, we are receiving sunlight from the sunlight. So that sunlight is given to the panel. From the panel, we are going to take a charge from charge. So that charge behaviors and all controlled with the DC charge controller. So from here directly, we can feed the load, right? So now here DC to AC inverter doesn't require, because the DC load is a DC load. So that's why we are simply avoiding that inverters. So here again you have some little bit advantages over the AC system. Here you can completely avoid inverter, and then cost losses, everything. Simply you are just removing or avoiding one stage of power conversions. All right, and next one. So from this concept, this DC microgrid technology has been developed in this market, and modern apartments started to implement this kind of concepts. Like the DC common voltage will be, either it may be depends the requirement, so they will have like 36 voltage or 54 voltage or 80 voltage or 220 voltage. So DC with the help of the current rating, so how much like 100 ampere or 150 ampere or 200 ampere, whatever it may be. So here again we have a PV panel and the battery systems, and in addition to that we can add wind power also. So here the major requirement is charge controller and the bidirectional converter. So these two converter will play a major role in this concepts, in these things. And important components of the entire PV system, so like a solar PV solar panels, and then mounting structures and connectors and junction boxes. Because actually in this panel, so you have a two terminal, one is a positive and another one is a negative, right? So generally the panel has a 25 years warranty. So suppose if you want to claim that warranty, so you should not break the wire. So there will be a connector, so like it may be a crocodile connector or clip type connector, whatever it may be. So you should use the panel with the same connector. If you break the connector, then you cannot claim the warranty. So because the panel manufacturer are providing you 25 years warranty. So in that case, this some components are important points to keep in your mind. And wirings, you have to use a DC cable from panel to inverter. So during that distance, you have to use only the DC cable. You should not use the AC cable. So separate cables are available in the market, so you just keep in your mind. And mounting structures, so both the landscape mounting structure and portrait mounting structures also available in the market. And again here you can do some research on this you can focus your research on this topic also, like a mechanical MPPT tracker along with algorithm, MPPT Mac algorithm. So here we can positively we can avoid the cloud, partial shading issues also. Suppose if you work in this aspect. And batteries, so you have to use some high quality batteries so that we can increase the maintenance, we can reduce the maintenance cost and all. And meters, of course, you have a meter, so that we can monitor the power generation as well as the power export, and then how much power we are importing from the grid. So these are not. And similarly, the grounding equipment. So until 1 to 2 kilowatt PV system, then the ground earthing is not required. Whereas if you go more than that value, then of course you should have a proper earthing, then only your equipment will be safe. Otherwise, it leaves issues. And so, how does MPPT charge controller works? See here. First, you should select the panel, solar panel, and you have to design a boost converter, and you have to implement one MPPT algorithm. And finally, we can connect the load. Okay, so these three are the main simple steps to design your MPPT charge controller. See here, I will take a screen. See here, here we cannot do anything. Whereas here, this panel, we can work in this panel, and then we can work some new. We can introduce some new concepts in the charge controller, and again we can introduce some techniques to increase the battery life and all, right? So for the implementing this entire block diagram into the real time manner, then we should have a simulation, the MATLAB simulation. So in the MATLAB simulation, how we can finish this four steps? So first you should have a proper solar panel. In the solar panel, you should identify the key parameters. So what are its key parameters? How we can take into this consideration, and then how we can design on boost converter. So what is an open loop converter, and then what is a closed loop converter? Everything we should know. And finally, we should implement the MPPT algorithm. Okay. See, let us take one solar panel data sheet. See, this panel data manufacturer Vikram Solar. So they have given some data sheet. So from this data sheet, we should identify some parameters. See, here they have clearly mentioned 295 to 325 wattage. So the ideal irradiation is 1000 watts per meter square, right? So that is the ideal irradiation. Whereas in real time, we cannot get maximum irradiation. So it will be up to maximum 800, 900 watts per meter square. So in that conditions, again, how this panel will give you the power. So for that one, we should know the PV curve of this particular panel. So in the MATLAB, they have given one inbuilt block diagram. So no need to connect anything, just select a rating. From that rating itself, we can identify the power. So that is a PV panel, PV module, PV curve. Similarly, we can identify the cell. See, actually, this is a PV array. So the entire combination is the PV array, and the single module is called module. That is the combination of cells. So per cell is the like this. So the combination either series or connections of the cells is connected to the module. This module comes to the array, right? So again, in this PV module, so 72 cells is connected. Some panel will give you 60 cells with 250 wattage or 300 wattage. Some manufacturer will give you 72 voltage with 325 wattage. So this is the cell, solar panel detailed specifications. So we should know about it. And next parameters are, so electrical parameters. So here maximum power, and then maximum voltage, maximum current, and open circuit voltage, short circuit voltage, and then module efficiency. How much efficiency if you keep, see here they have claimed standard test conditions. Standard test conditions, nothing but that irradiation is created artificial. So they have tested with that data. Then they are claiming this kind of parameters. Suppose if you are purchasing 325 wattage panel, so it won't give you at 325 wattage at any point of time, whereas except some conditions, right? But we cannot meet in the particular time. Suppose if you have a 1000 watts per meter square, but the temperature may be different in real time manner. I'm telling that real time manner. Similarly, if you have a 225 degree Celsius, then the irradiation may be 800 or 500 or 600. So in that conditions, the wattage, the maximum watt from the panel may differ. Okay, so you have to take this kind of consideration. Similarly, again, that open circuit voltage and then open circuit current, so other things are not presented in the data sheet. And so these are all some this information will not be available in the data sheet of the PV panel. So this is general data sheets. So this by using this one, we can perfectly implement the MPPT models. MPPT algorithm in the simulations, as well as the bug, I mean hardware also, because actually in the hardware also you have to develop a controller, I mean firmware to activate the microcontroller, right? So in that conditions you should use this kind of parameters. I will share you this presentations at the end of the session, so you just use those things. And so how we can identify the how we can understand cell of the PV panel. See here in the MATLAB, I will show you the MATLAB file also. So before that, just we will discuss here the theory part. See here, if you take this pan, this cell, so cell is directly connected to the load, and this module, and then the this module has a current and voltage sensor. And again, so this entire simulation is developed in the SimScape, MATLAB SimScape. So again, that the physical parameter is the entire components are modeled with the physical component parameters. So in that conditions, that solver option have to add, and a ground option. Ground, this is a ground component, and here we can feed the irradiations. Suppose if you give a 1000 watts per meter square, then the cell, this particular cell. Like this particular cell may be a, it's like a diode, right? So the diode voltage maximum it will be 0.6 voltage, right? So current may be different. So with respect to the physical parameter, the components, materials, material properties, this cell will work in different efficiency. Yeah? Different, it will give you maximum current, but the voltage will be the 0.6 voltage. That is a cell voltage. 0.6 voltage, and let us open the MATLAB Simulink. I will open the MATLAB just to be on the line. Can you tell me, anyone? Are you watching my MATLAB window?
Yeah.
So now I'm opening the MATLAB window. So here the entire same simulation is modeled. Still we can go step by step, but the time is too limited. So we have to cover 4 more demos. So I just right away I'm just taking this simulation. Then I'm just explaining you. So you just ask your questions whatever you have in the simulations. So during the simulation, you can interrupt me at any point of time. Not a problem at all. So you just ask me more questions. And see here, this solar cell is connected with the resistance. It's just a simple connections, right? See here, in this solar cell property is 0.6 voltage, and then the short circuit current will be the 7.3 ampere. And again, here we are connecting that maximum, we are allowing the irradiance is the maximum 1000 watts per meter square. Right, and so here we are connecting, we are supplying that value. This is just a SimScape constant, 1000 unit is a watts per meter square. And here the resistance is the variable resistor. So this resistor slightly we are increasing from zero to maximum. And if you run the simulation. Yeah, just it will take some time because actually my laptop was completely loaded. Just be patient. Just give me 2 to 3 seconds. Yeah, so that simulation will give you this kind of IV curve. See here, the short circuit current, the maximum current is a 7 ampere, and then voltage is about 0.6 voltage. See. You can identify. We can identify the IV curve behaviors. Suppose if you increase the voltage, then the current cell voltage, the current short circuit current will get decreased. right? And similarly for lower voltage, it will gives you the higher amount of current. And again, the PV curve of the cell is, this is the PV curve of the cell. So here we can take a maximum power will be about 3.3 wattage, maximum power at the desired voltage. Right, so at the desired voltage, so you can operate anywhere between the maximum to next nearer value. Right, so this is the similar cell solar cell volt cell curve, and again we can take a similar kind of output from in the PV panel. So like a PV panel, nothing but the combination of which is connected with the module. So that is the module. I mean, again, module is a number of modules connected together, and then finally we will get a panel, right? So this is simple diode behaviors to understand the basics of solar cells. And the next topic, we should identify the boost converter. We have to design one boost converter. So to design a boost converter, professionals, so no need to discuss about the basics of boost converter. So straight away we can go for the design. So how we can design a boost converter? See here, so I will open one Excel sheet. So here we can take a graph. So how the things close? See here, I'm going to design one 300 wattage boost converter. So this 300 wattage boost converter will work under certain parameters. So first we should identify the power rating and efficiency rating. We should identify. Are you able to see my Excel sheet?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, and we should identify the frequency, switching frequency. This is the switching frequency. So here, if you are working with non-isolated converter, then you cannot go for higher frequency range. So that time you should use a lower frequency range. So I am keeping 5000 kilohertz. Suppose if you are using for high frequency or isolated converters, then you can go for 20 kilohertz range, like 10 kilohertz, 20 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz, 150 kilohertz, 200 kilohertz. So whatever you want. Whenever you increase the frequency, you can increase the power density, that is the resolution of the converter will be huge, but at the same time the power loss also will be a huge. So just we have to keep in that mind while choosing the switching frequency. And we should identify the output voltage. See, again here one more point is that the boost converter always requires a feedback loop to regulate the desired output voltage. If you cannot run run the open boost converter output in the open loop, suppose the converter will give you the output, but the output voltage will not be a steady state. Suppose if you want to maintain that output boost converter output in a steady state manner, then you should implement a closed loop algorithm. So that closed loop again one more topic to regulate all the things. And desired output voltage, fault gate voltage, and then from this I'm just taking the current. Suppose if you can keep 50 voltage, so this sheet will give you the resonance balance data. So here in the in the block diagram, the key components are, first thing is the inductance, right? So because of this inductance only, it's going to work as a boost converter. And similarly, this capacitor. So with this capacitor only, the converter will give you the DC voltage. So that is a steady state voltage. Otherwise, say, it will give you that random voltage. The out in the out V naught, huge ripples will be there. So this capacitor will help you to remove the ripple, and finally it will give you the steady state DC voltage. Right. So it's being a it's plays a major role in this converter. So these are all the key components. So here we should calculate those components with the help of these parameters, this formula. See here again, decide parameters are maximum current and minimum current, how much current you are allowing to take a call. See here, if you change the output voltage, so instead of 50 to 48 voltage, the entire current will be there. And similarly, by choosing the power rating, that output voltage and then output current, everything will be decided. And input voltage, right? So you see here, if you take this converter, this input voltage is given by us. So we should give the limit, that is the maximum voltage, how I can feed the voltage to this converter, maximum voltage. Similarly, the minimum voltage. So we know the maximum and minimum voltage range from the previous model called the solar PV model, that we know. So we have to take that decision, right? And that's why the real time inverters won't work under 12 voltage or under 24 voltage. Suppose if it is a 3, if you take a 3 and 1 kilowatt, so 1 kVA of on-grid inverter, so that inverter will not work less than about 48, I think, so I'm not correct. Some certain voltage will be there. So that depends on the manufacturer. So the manufacturer will give you, will mention that range, what is the maximum range and what is the minimum range. And so that we should decide. So once if you choose it, then we can take a L value and then C value, similarly that the resistance value. And from this we can calculate the inductances also. So that is again one more separate topic. So here if you discuss that topic, not again time will not be sufficient. Already again 45 minutes over. So this is the boost converter design procedure. So if you design, if you implement that one, then we can take a output. So let us open the boost converter. See here, we are going to see the only the open loop operations of the boost converter. So the open loop simulation is modeled. See here, I am giving that input voltage 30 and then whatever I have calculated in the Excel sheet. So that voltage, that data only I am going to feed it here. And the corresponding output voltage, I am going to take it. All right. And the switching frequency is about 5000 hertz. And then pulse width will be, the desired pulse width will be the 37.5%. If you run the simulation, then obviously the voltage of this boost converter will be higher than or lesser than this one, because whenever you implement the closed loop, then only that V naught will get a steady state value, that is a desired output value. Whereas in the buck converter, it's not like that, because there is no any energy storage device. Whereas in this boost converter here, the we are playing with energy storage element, so that energy storage will not be a controllable for unless you have a proper algorithm. So that's why the boost control will not give you. So I see here our desired output voltage is about 48 voltage, but it gives you 58 voltage, right? And the current is about 8 to 9 ampere, I think so. Yeah, so it's about 7.8 ampere, the maximum current. So here if you adjust the value, then we can take a maximum or minimum voltage. So by implementing proper control algorithm to regulate the desired output voltage. So simply see, actually the idea is, so we are going to feed this converter to the PV panel. So finally we are, our idea is we have to extract the maximum power from the panel. So once if you extracted the power from the panel, then we can do anything towards either the grid or it's a battery. So we can regulate it with that additional circuit for the desired next stage power input. Okay, so this entire motto of the converter is only we have to extract the maximum power from the panel. So that's why we are implementing this logic. Yeah, so here, so let's move to the next one. So this boost converter will give you the proper output voltage. So here we can measure it, which, how much voltage is getting and then how much current and how what is the input voltage and what is the output voltage, everything you can get it. Right? And similarly, so now the boost converter is ready and the solar cell is ready. So from the solar cell idea, we have to take a PV panel, and the, from the PV panel again we have to move forward, right? So now we have to implement an MPPT algorithm to change the data. So for that one, you have to open the mat. We have to go for the demo 3. Yeah. You, dear participants, you please ask any questions if you have at any point of time. So I am ready to give you the answer. I will try to give my maximum output. See here, this is the MPPT charge controller. So whatever we decide to develop the boost converter, so this boost converter is connected with this PV model. So here the this PV array is readily available in the MATLAB library. Just take a PV array, and here we are modeling how much that is the maximum power and minimum power, whatever it may be. So we can take it. See here, we are taking the PV model is about maximum power is about 218 watts, the maximum power. So we took a 4 panels, so it's about 800 wattage, right? So if you can change whatever you want. So see here, there are a variety of options are there. So you can choose whatever you want, and then you can try with the different combinations. And if you choose the data, and if you can, if you select this option, so for choosing the PV panel, it will give you the proper output. See here, it shows you two output. One is that the PV curve, and another one is the IV curve. See, whenever you change the irradiations, so this is for, so here we have simulated three irradiations. One is 100, and then 500, and then 1000. Right? See here, this is a 100, 500, and then 1000 irradiance. So for the 1000 irradiations, the maximum output, if you double click it, you can identify, you can take our data. So this is the maximum output, right? So 875 wattage is the maximum output, and at this point, you can expect 58 voltage, 58.6 voltage is the maximum voltage. Similarly, at this point, you can expect the maximum current is 14.9 ampere is the maximum current. So with this three data, you can develop your boost converter, right? Yeah. So let us close the graph and let us move to the simulation. Yeah. So now the PV model is developed, and this is that constant para block which is available in the library, and we are keeping this 25 is a standard rating. That is, the temperature is 25 we are keeping. So based on your locations, you can change the data. And similarly, that is that this is the irradiance input. So from morning 6 a.m. to evening 6 p.m. we are just simulating, we are feeding the data, right? And so from this point, we are taking the positive or negative voltage from the PV array, and this model is a measurement block which is used to take a PV voltage and then PV current, so that by multiplying this data, so we can implement the maximum power point, right? So for that one, so we should know what is the MPPT algorithm under. here how what are all the methods are available in the MPPT. So one, the first one is the constant voltage and the open circuit voltage, short circuit current, and then P and O algorithm, similarly IC algorithm, and temperature parametric difference. So these are all some MPPT methods. So in general, people use the P and O and IC algorithms generally used in this industry. And nowadays, actually, we used fuzzy logic and neural network based algorithm. Also, we did some researches on it. So this is a basic formula. These are the theory. So whenever the maximum power is there, then we will keep or we can increase the duty cycle. Similarly, if there is a duty cycle, maximum power is not available or less power, then we can decrease the duty cycle so that we can get a maximum current or maximum power from the panel. So like that is a basic algorithm. So I will explain you in the how we can work it out. Similarly, this is IC algorithm. Same way, just everything is just the if else logic. So how the parameter is T1, T0 state and then T1 state. And see here, in this simulation, the PV array is modeled and then our boost converter is ready. So now we have to implement in the MPPT algorithm. So you know how you are claiming your converter is working for under MPPT algorithm. To identify this question, so we should monitor or we should have an ideal graph of the PV array. So if you compare the PV array output with the converter output, then we can say it is a maximum. This converter is working under the maximum power point tracking. So my algorithm is working fine. Like that, we can claim it. Okay, so that we will see in later how we can calculate it. So just let us run the simulation. So actually for MPPT algorithm, we are giving the three input. One is that PV voltage, panel voltage, and then panel current, and step size. So this is called the step size. How to take a data or how to measure the panel voltage. So this is called simply we can say the sample data. So if you open the block, see here, we are receiving three kind of data. One is called the maximum, that is the instantaneous voltage and then instantaneous current, and the delta. So this is the step size, right? So by implementing just if else logic, see here, whenever the power is measured with old data to new data, then it will be the duty cycle will be increased or decreased. So based on this data, we are taking the duty cycle. So this duty cycle is given to the PWM generator. So this is again a PWM generator for DC-DC converter, which is the default block is available in the MATLAB library. So we can try to use it. And so here at this point of the load, we can take a output. So we can measure the output voltage and we can take a measure. We can measure the performance of the boost converter. See here, I have measured. So this is the ideal parameter, like a panel direct parameter. So this is the panel direct parameter. We are just multiplying this one, then here we can get ideal power. Similarly, this is the converter voltage. Sorry, this is the IPV VPV, this is the ideal power, and then converter output voltage and then our converter output current. So now we are comparing these two parameters. So here voltage, individual voltage, and the current. So this is the converter voltage and then converter current. First graph is VPV. Yeah, so this is the VPV and IPV. There is a panel voltage and then panel current. Similarly, converter voltage and then converter current. If you open the block, you can take, you can measure it as. So the converter will give you, sorry, by a panel generate voltage. The converter is trying to give you at nearly 80 voltage at the desired range. Similarly, the current. Current graph. So here about 7 ampere. Again here also some current. It's about 4 to 5 ampere nearly. And this step is happening because this irradiation is keep on changing, right? From morning to evening, this graph. I mean this data keep on change, right? So we are giving this kind of data. So if you change the data, then definitely it will give you very different output. So that we can check it. This is the irradiation data. So initially it is a zero. So during that period, the volt power is not generated. So irradiation has happened. So now it is a 450 watts per meter square. So here we are generating about a 400 wattage. Similarly, we are increasing 700 watts per meter square. And consequently, we are generating 650 voltage, 650 watts. So this is a maximum or still let's wait. Yeah. So now the irradiation is again increased to 900 watts per meter square. Then again the converter is generating the maximum power, right? Similarly, if you reduce the irradiation, then the converter output also will get reduced. See, actually we cannot. The irradiation system keep on, it's not a constant parameter, so it will keep on changing. We cannot control this parameter, whereas we can control this parameter. But the key point is both suppose irradiation is reduced, so that time also we cannot keep this converter as a maximum voltage because the source is absolutely it's going to be reduced. So in that case, output also will get reduced. Right, so here we should not expect the regulations. So here we can our main motto is we should extract the maximum power from the panel. So that is the MPPT algorithm, MPPT converter's ultimate aim. Right, because the panel will always give you maximum efficiency will be about 17.6 or it will be available in the data sheet. The maximum efficiency will be about 17.6%. So in that conditions, we should have a proper converter to take up power from the panel. Right. So here the PV irradiation is reduced. So simultaneously, this graph, boost converter output also it's got reduced, right? So like this we can take it. If you open this graph, yeah, see here convert panel output power. And this is the converter output power. See here, the panel output power huge disturbances are there, whereas the converter output power, it's there is no any disturbances. It's giving you perfect output voltage, output to power. So in that sense, we can regulate or we can increase our by either battery or inverter lifetime. Okay, so for that purpose also, this converter is going to work. Yeah, so now let us move to the slide. So now it's ready, so we can integrate with a grid tie inverter. So for that one, again we should know the basics of inverter, how it is working, and then how we can generate in that one, how we can integrate the grid tie inverter. So in this entire session we are going to discuss in detail about what is a boost MPPT algorithm and how it is implemented. Similarly, what is a inverter and then how we can interact with the grid. So these things we are going to discuss. And in inverters, inverter segment, so input is a fixed DC and then output is a controlled output, AC output. So by changing the parameter, that is a PWM of the MPPT, we can control our AC output voltage. So to understand the inverter working principle, so this is we are feeding the input voltage, it's a DC voltage. By changing the gate pulses, we are taking the alternative output voltage. All right. So this is the alternative. Sometimes it will be a positive voltage, and then next after some time it will get a negative voltage. So on an average voltage will be the AC voltage or alternative voltage, alternative power supply. See here. So the types of inverters are series, parallel, and then single phase inverter and multi-level inverter. So based on output voltage, we can classify those converters, those inverters. So series inverter with the help of LNC resonance property, it's classified as a series. The resonance components is placed inside in series with the then it is a series inverter. Similarly, it is available to the parallel, then it is a parallel inverter. And again, the single phase, three phase inverter, all you know very well about it. And then multi-level inverter, suppose if you employ a single phase inverter, you have to keep filters to activate your load. Right, so to improve your load performance, you have to keep a filter. Suppose if you use a multi-level inverter, simply you can avoid the filters. We can increase the better harmonic issues in the output side of inverter concepts. So instead of square pulse, always the load needs a AC output voltage. For suppose if it is a LRC. Right, so in that, to achieve this kind of voltage, we should employ some filters. Right, so if you employ filter, then again the inverter cost and then size of the inverter, everything will increase. So to avoid, people have introduced the multi-level inverter. So in this multi-level inverter, the same output voltage is divided into multiple segment, and then by switches combinations, we are achieving this kind of output voltage. So finally, we can get a smooth sine voltage. See, suppose if you are not able to get a sine voltage, then what it will happen? So do you have any idea about it? Suppose if you are applying this square pulse to the induction motor, then what is the issue with the induction motor? Do you have any idea about it?
Participants,
if you have any idea, you can share it or you can ask me any questions. See here, let us discuss. Suppose if you apply this square pulse to the induction motor, if you take this two instant. See here, suppose if you take T is 1 and then T is 2. Okay, so this is this two interval. See, general flux linkage will be the rate of change of flux inside the stator, right? So here the rate of change of flux will be always constant during this period. See, if you apply this voltage, the flux linkage will be like this. So during this particular period, this flux linkage difference is same, similar thing. So during this period, the inside the motor, the pulsating torque will get introduced. So due to that point, the load will get affected. Suppose if you travel with a lift, like 10 passengers or 50 passengers lift, so you may feel sometimes that the lift will. Whenever if it is loaded fully, then it will move drastically. That on and off will be smooth, but the travel time will be abnormal. So the outside velocity is less than that inside velocity. So in that conditions, you may feel some fear inside your body. So that is called a load effect. So due to avoid that situation, so we are trying to implement always feed sine output to the load, right? So in that conditions, the multi-level inverter will play a major role in this concept. And so how we can integrate PV solar grid to this system? We know that inverter is giving you the output, AC output. So this is the existing PV system. So how it is working and all PV grid system. So I will explain in detail how we can implement it. See here, we are taking the inverter output. From this inverter output, we should keep in EMF filter. So from this EMF filter, this voltage is given to that AC grid. Once again, sir, actually, sir, mic is on. Can you mute your mic?
Sir,
your mic. Yeah. So this is the typical PV grid inverter system. So let us check our system, how we can do. So first, you should have a inverter specification. So what is the specifications you have? And the second, you have to design your inverter. You have to choose your controller, how we can integrate the controller. And finally, you have to complete with the simulations. Right, so let us take a design specification. So this is the inverter specification. So this is a 2 kVA inverter. Output voltage is 230 voltage. The current is the 9 ampere, and then fundamental frequency is that 50 hertz. And DC bus voltage. So it depends. That is a 325 voltage DC bus voltage. So based on your here, you can feed up lower voltages also. In that conditions, you should have a isolation transformer to boost up the voltage, because in the inverter we cannot boost the voltage, so we can convert the voltage from AC to DC, right? So I am taking this much of rating, and hertz. So this is again to reduce the, if you increase the switching size, switching frequency, again you should work more air. So filter will give you a lot of issues. So to avoid that one, I am keeping lesser switching frequency. So you can have like 1 kilowatts also, it will work. But simultaneously, that inverter resolution will be different. So how we? So this is the specification, inverter specifications. So let us take a filter design. I took a LCL filter. So this filter, this is a formula for designing this LCL value. Okay, see here. This is the DC bus voltage, and then this is the frequencies, and then load current, right? Similarly, we should take a switching frequencies also. So this is the thumb. We can keep anything. So this is the fundamental frequency levels, and similarly, again, the voltage drop across the both inductor is 10%. That is this one. 0.02 VDC square, and similarly here also the voltage across the value is 0.3. So here, one second. So here also that this range is defined. Again, it depends the type of the filter you can use it. So for this, this formula will work for this this topology only, not different topology. Suppose if you use LNC or L filter. So this formula won't, so give you only LCL filter only. We take and grid controller is phase lock loop. So how, why this grid controller is required? Sometimes see the grid the inverter output we can take 50 hertz exactly. Okay, because we are feeding the PWM is in our control. So the microcontroller, if you control the, if you generate a PWM at the exact figure 50 hertz, then this inverter will generate a 50 hertz. Whereas in our grid, it will not be like that. So the grid always generate a non-permanent value. Like this frequency, the grid frequency will be either it, sometimes it will be 50 hertz, sometimes it will be 50.1 hertz, sometimes it will be 49.8 hertz or 49.5 hertz, right? So always we should generate a inverter output with respect to the, that output frequency must match with the grid frequency. Then only that reactive power will not generate. So we can avoid the reactive power. Otherwise, this will introduce the reactive power and then phase disturbances, everything will introduce. Right? So to avoid that one only, we are using this thing. Again, the grid controller here we took as a phase lock loop to generate or to identify the grid frequency. Right? Here, let us go for the grid data. Yeah, see here. And this is simply developed inverter. So this is the DC bus voltage, one voltage DC bus voltage, and then this is the universal bridge inverter type. So here the four MOSFETs will be there, and again that this is a PWM generator, which is a ready-made block available in the library browser. You can take it. And again, I have connected LCL filter. If you run the simulation again, we can take here we are getting AC output voltage and same time AC current, right? So before the filter it will be like this. So this is the after filter and this is the before filter. So voltage is the voltage is this much and current is this much, right? So if you apply the filter, we can take exact voltage. Still further we have to improve the filter component, so that we have to take in real time consideration, and we can take it. So this is the inverter output voltage and the current. And now we should implement the grid model to this inverter. So how we can do that one? If you take the grid example, yeah. See, this is the grid model. The same inverter I took, and here so this is the LCL model, and here see. Connected with resistance, it's a very small resistance. It's for simulation settings I have used this one. And so this is the grid input. Grid input is isolated with the help of this ideal switch. Suppose if this switch is enabled 1 or enabled 0, then this inverter is disconnected from the grid. This is the load model. Okay, so this load will get a power from the inverter when switch is high, right? And how we can interact with the in grid. See, for that one we are taking the voltage measurement across the grid module, and the voltage is given to the PLL model. This is the PLL model. So here you just feed the data, just change the data. By default it will be 60 hertz. So if you keep 50 hertz, then it will lock into that 50 hertz output, right? So then in that whatever you are feeding the power voltage to this model, so this model will keep on generate triangular wave with respect to the input frequency. So that we can check in detail with the help of this simulation. So this is the triangular graph and this is the modulation index, so that I will explain in detail. And this is the phase shift. So by changing this phase shift, so we can actively control active and reactive power to the load. So if you take up MATLAB-based function, we can understand how this lock is happening actually. So finally, we should have a same sine function. See, actually earlier simulation we discussed one graph, right? Yeah. See here, it needs again modulation index value only. So now also here we need to change the modulation index with the help of PL. Yeah, see here. So this block is just a simply block. That's just a simple function. The modulation index is generated with the help of the PLL output. So the x is the fundamental frequency with the help of the previous input. So that is shift -k is that step size. So how we are separating that into degree, number of degrees. So if you multiply, if you take a sine value for this graph, we can take it as a modulation index. So once if you generated that data can be given to that sine pulse with the modulation. So here you can use the default block, otherwise you know sine wave as well as the triangular wave. So to replace the sine wave, you can feed this modulation index to that sine wave. So finally, this PWM given to the inverter. So this inverter, now the inverter is getting the pulse frequency based on the grid frequency. If you run the simulation, just a second, it's taking my laptop is getting ready. Yeah, so let us run the simulation. Let us verify the output, how it is. Yeah, the simulation is running. See, actually in this simulation I have changed the two states. I have used this circuit is sometimes it is open, So let us check how the functioning. See here we are measuring inverter output. This is the grid voltage. Similarly, this is inverter voltage. So right. So this is the LCL filter. And again here also we can check. So for this period, for this period, during this period, the grid is connected to the inverter. So the voltage almost is in phase with the grid voltage. The inverter output voltage is in phase with the grid voltage. So during this period, this inverter is disconnected from the grid. For the grid. So during that period also, actually, that earlier problem, earlier problem is connected. Actually, here we are taking this graph only. This is as a fundamental graph. So basically, taking the speed will be synchronized with the grid frequency, right? So this load voltage and graph. At any point of time, whenever the grid is empty, so during that time, the current is this is the load current. So the model is sharing the current. So whereas the current are not available in the grid, so it's absolutely zero. The thing is feeding the voltage. Due to that active reactive power differences, its inverter all generates. Power, that negative power to that one, so that inverter load will have a power any point of time. So for this is a basic, again it's a very simple grid integration network. So again here we have additional modality based grid control. So that topic also, and like this we can integrate the grid to the PV systems. And I want to go to the real time hardware fabrication. So let us go for the bonus content called gate driver design. So how, see, actually so far we have developed only, we have worked for the theoretical part. So this model will be available in the textbook. So we have to get up by experience on the practical, whenever you are involving on the practical hardware development. So based from that point, you can get this kind of stuff. So I can share my idea how this can be developed. See here, generally in the application block diagram, the input is the load will receive a rated voltage. So the microcontroller will generate a pulse. So pulse will directly connected to the MOSFET. Whereas this microcontroller here in this model, the microcontroller will play a major role, right? So if any fault happening in the microcontroller, obviously the entire algorithm, entire circuit may leave a faulty circuit, right? So it will, there is the fault will create. So to avoid that one, we are introducing the gate driver module. So we are introducing the gate driver module to isolate the MOSFET. So to isolate the MOSFET from the power circuit. Sorry, to isolate the microcontroller from the power circuit, because this power circuit will have a 10 ampere or 20 ampere or 100 ampere, or it may be a even 500 ampere also. Whereas the microcontroller will, the maximum ampere current will be about 10 milliamps. Okay, so this is the so due to this differences, the current, suppose if the power current power signal flows into the lower signal, problem. To avoid that one, we are using this gate driver. Okay, and so in the power circuit, these are the components which is used to get a desired output voltage. And So again here, how to choose the and how to design our gate driver circuit and how to provide, how to choose the isolate and isolation components. Again, there are a variety of types of isolation model methods are there, and how to design a proper gate driver to the circuit applicable. So those all we will discuss in detail. If you take any MOSFETs or switches, that is a power electronic switches, we can simply understand this is a like a similar ideal switches. So if you take this switch, so this is a mechanical switch. If you turn on this switch, then your application will get activated. Similarly, MOSFET, IGBT, SCR, similar thing. So only thing here we are using my external mechanical forces, whereas here we are going to external electronic forces called the PWM pulses. We can identify, we can understand that very simple concept. What is inside? Of course, if you apply gate pulses to the devices, what is happening inside? See, for example, in any MOSFET, any semiconductor switches. So there will be a depletion layer, right? Simply we can understand the depletion layer. So whenever you pass the current or voltage to the device, that is just nothing but gate to source or gate to emitter. Okay, so whenever it reaches the minimum minimum requirement, if you take a MOSFET, so you have to apply minimum 4.8 voltage or 5 voltage to the gate source, then this will happen. This condition will happen. So once if it is connected, then again the MOSFET will ready to carry your drain to carry your current from drain to source point. Suppose if it is not ready, then the MOSFET is ideally it's going to be a turn off state. Okay, so this behaviors and all, it's going to happen within a particular cycle, within a switching frequency cycle itself, it's going to happen. So to understand that one, to design a gate driver circuit, so first you have to identify your applications. Either are you going to develop a AC to DC application network, or AC to AC circuit, or DC to DC, or AC. So for all the circuits, you should have different or into you should have a different gate driver. Then only we can meet our load requirements a proper manner. Because MOSFET you should have some requirements, IGBT should have some requirements, right? So based on these applications, you have to choose the device. So based on the device, you have to use the gate driver, right? Here based on this device, how to choose and all. So how to choose the MOSFET and how to choose the IGBT. So for this kind of ranges, if it is at less than 10 ampere switching frequency 10 kilohertz and the voltage range is this one, then you can go for with the IGBT. Similarly, for higher volt power range, you have to go for the IGBT. So less than 1000 voltage and then switching frequencies, this is so and so. So for this period, you can use the MOSFET, and wherever the switching frequency is higher, then obviously you have to use the MOSFETs. So again, this data will be provided by the manufacturer. So from the manufacturer data, from data sheet only, we can choose it. See, for example, if you take this applications, actually in our circuit, 5000 is the switching frequency. And voltage range is that 30 voltage, right? But here also, if you use the 500 voltage 500 voltage, still you can go for the MOSFETs. So suppose if you are a converter, the 300 voltage. Switching frequency is 5000 kilohertz. Okay, so it will comes. If you take a 300 voltage, nothing but 50 voltage with some current, right? So our requirement will lies at here. So according to this sheet, you can choose the MOSFET, right? But at the same time, you can use the IGBT also. But you should have some similar differences. You should add something to this one in your gate driver circuit. Okay, so you can take a call on the design while doing the design. And so let us take our converter rating. So this is a 2 kilowatt converter, and then voltage is the 230 voltage. And again, the ampere rating is 9 ampere, and frequency is that 50 hertz of fundamental frequency. So whatever we took in the inverter design, so the same top, same rating we taken to here also. So here again, you can use 9 ampere with 230 watt kilohertz, then 50 hertz the maximum. Switching frequencies for 4050 hertz. So here, according to this sheet, you have to choose IGBT, right? So the 230 voltage is lies at here, and the spike voltage will be about again the safety factor. You should have about two times. About it will be 460 voltage, right? So you have to use the IGBT, but still for low power range, you can choose MOSFET also. So some type of MOSFET will help you, because IGBT will be costly than the MOSFET for this kind of low power ranges. See, IGBT will have about suppose if you take a 200 or 300 rupees, then MOSFET will be less than that price. So again, it's subject to market conditions. So again, in the market how much supplier is going to give you. Again, actually, from my experience, my supplier will work based on the quantity you are going to take it. Like one quantity, 10 quantity, that's and all, they won't consider. Like 1K per month or 2K per month or 10K per quarter or per half year. So like that, they will demand it. So in that conditions only, we can work it out the price values. And again, the safety factor. So again, there are different safety factors are there. So this is some standard safety factors for domestic applications. If you have a 230 voltage, suppose if this inverter, the same rating inverter, if you are going to use in your home, then you can use 460 IR of 460 MOSFET, right? So it will go, it will work up to 500 voltage. Whereas the same rating of inverter, if you are going to use in your ship or defense applications, so in that conditions, you have to use 2300 voltage devices, because that we need more safety. Okay, so based on the data, based on the safety factor, you can choose your device. So from our requirement, we took our desired voltage is the 450 and the ampere rating is the 15 ampere. Okay, so here based on these things, we have to pick what are all the gate driver properties, how to identify or how to choose, how to fix the how to implement these properties into our circuit. Because the gate driver is not a single IC, right? We have to design one IC, PC schematics. So that schematics, we should have all this kind of facility. Yeah, just give me 2 minutes time. I will back. Actually, I have some local requirement. Just to give, sir, can you just hold just 1 minute?
ओके ओके ओके
ओके जस्ट ए सेकेंड आई विल गिव यू आई विल बैक इन टू वन मिनट
ओके सर
Hi, I am back. Sorry for participants. Just yeah. See, now we should implement these properties into our schematics. So for that one, we have to do some. We have to add some components to the circuits, right? So let us see one by one. So first, let us take. So first we should identify we should understand the structure of the MOSFET. So how the MOSFET is structured. So these are all the while doing the fabrication of the MOSFET use different die casting to model the MOSFET. So the famous method is that again here the V-groove method to fabricate to the MOSFET. So each and every MOSFET structure will have a different properties called gating properties called actually the capacitor. I mean, on state capacitor will place while you apply voltage or while you apply power to the MOSFET. So that capacitance, the parasitic capacitance. So by using the range of the capacitance, then the we can increase or we can decrease the speed of the gating devices, right? So to understand that, so this is the ideal character, ideal equivalent circuit of the MOSFET. If you take MOSFET, so this is the actually if you buy any MOSFET, so we are seeing this three terminal only. So this is the gate terminal and then the drain terminal and source. Inside the device, so the entire model, the entire components will be there. Okay, so this is this capacitance will place a major role to change its also at the transient state behaviors, and this capacitor will used this capacitor the diode is used to regulate the spikes. See, for example, suppose if you turn on switch to in the conditions. The voltage across the MOSFET will be, across the MOSFET will be zero. Voltage across will be zero. The current will be maximum. So while you turn on in the device, when you turn off the device, the MOSFET voltage across the MOSFET will rise into the from minimum to maximum value. Sir, actually, sir, your mic is on. So your voltage across the MOSFET during the turn on time to turn off time will change in drastic manner, right? Suppose if your spikes is happening inside the MOSFET, so like that spikes. So this kind of spikes can be controlled with the help of this diode along with the capacitor. And again, famous number circuit is called RCD's number. So that will help that we should add addition. If you add that circuit to your device, then we can keep or we can completely remove the spikes. Okay, so before starts our design, we should understand how the MOSFET is turn on mechanism is happening. Similarly, turn off mechanism is happening. If you take our equivalent circuit, so this is our equivalent circuit, right? So this is our equivalent. If you take this equivalent circuit, so see, this is a circuit here. Up to this point, so this is the MOSFET device which we are purchasing from the market. Okay, and these are all the additional circuits which we are going to design for the gate driver circuit. Okay, so now your source is release the voltage. So you see, for example, if you turn on the pulse, if you are applying gate pulse to this MOSFET, particular MOSFET, so at this point, the current tries to flows into the circuit, right? So this current will divided into two part because of this capacitance. So CGD, CGB, right? So this is the unstated capacitor parasitic effect due to that Miller effect. So this capacitor is going to start. So because actually it's not a physical capacitor, it's a semiconductor property. Due to that property, this capacitance will create. Okay, so due to this capacitance effect, the current will divide into two types. One is called one current will flows into the upper side and another current will flows into the lower side. Okay, so initially if capacitor is discharged, if there is no any charge, if capacitor put under the charging mode, the capacitor will pull more amount of current to the device. Okay, see, if you are that's why the current we should supply enough gate current to turn on the device at a proper time. Okay, so this capacitor will tries to pull off maximum amount of current. Suppose I will share you the data sheet. That current will be mentioned in the data sheet. Okay, so we can understand the graph. See, the four major parameters is VGS, this is the gate to source voltage, and then gate current, similarly drain source voltage and drain current. So ideally what we should have, if you want to turn on MOSFET, then the drain must be maximum, the gate to source or drain to source voltage will be minimum, right? See, right, the drain to source voltage will be minimum. So now if you apply gate voltage, so immediately the gate current will be huge. So instead it will goes up, and once if gate source voltage reaches the threshold value, then it tries to gradually reduced to the minimum value, and during that time only the gate drain current will try to kick start. If the maximum, if it reaches the maximum, still the voltage across the device will be available, right? Whenever it reaches the maximum voltage, then only it will try to reduce it. Okay, so ideally, suppose if you speak ideally, during this time, because actually we have started the gate pulse at here, right? So during this period itself, the gate voltage, drain voltage must be zero. But here one, at this point only that the drain to source voltage approaches to zero. So these are all called transient times. Okay, so due to this equivalent circuit capacitances, this gate current increased this much of level. Okay, so now our gate should supply this much of current, then only the MOSFET will get turn on. Otherwise, it won't get turn on. It will take some time to turn on. Similarly, and actually this turn on time and then turn off time, everything will be mentioned. Okay, see here, turn delay time and then turn off delay time. So while choosing your devices, you have the data of switching frequency. So suppose if you choose 1000 kilohertz or 500 kilohertz, then the on time off time of the particular switching frequency must be higher than this on time off time standard data sets value. Otherwise it won't work. And see, he mentioned to source and then reverse leakage current, how much they have mentioned. Okay, so 100 nano ampere, some IGB have a 2 ampere also, it requires 2 amperes. Similarly, turn off mechanism. From the voltage from the gate, see if you pull down the voltage from the gate, so again, so it will tries to discharge this capacitance. This is the parasitic capacitance. So this capacitance will tries to reduce its voltage. Okay. So in that conditions also, it will take some time to settle it. So that we can understand from this graph. We try to raise gate pulses, but it won't it approaches to zero. So due to its energy available inside the device, so some time to reach its zero value. So this is called turn off delay time, and this is a turn off fault time. This is not a rise time. This is a fault time. Okay, so the same data will be available. So you have to while you choosing your device, then you should take care about these parameters. So this is SCR characteristics. So now the first parameter we should implement isolations. So how we can isolate the microcontroller from the power circuit? So for that one, we have a two options. One is called optical isolation, and another one is a galvanic isolation. The optical isolation is nothing but it's electronic. Ice from this IC element, we can separate two grounds. One is a microcontroller ground and another one is a power ground. Similarly, the galvanic isolation is nothing but the transformer. So the transformer, pulse transformers used to regulate or isolate the things. Suppose these are some familiar ICs for this standard switching frequencies. Suppose if you use a 25 kilohertz, then the MCT2E, which is very low cost, about 15 rupees to 20 rupees maximum, you can use it. It's a very simple 3-pin IC only. And similarly, for 25 kilohertz, TLP250 is perfectly, it will work. So similarly, IR2110, 2111, and 2112, so everything will help you to reach this particular frequency. So, but those drivers will not have isolation, so separately you have to add the isolations. And for higher frequencies, you can use this kind of MOSFETs, power devices. So if you Google it, you can get these data sheets. And how we can we can supply more amount of current. See, actually from our microcontroller we will get only the pulse positions. Okay, so from this pulse positions we should amplify the current. So at particular time period, see, this is the microcontroller data, 5 voltage with ampere, sorry, 10 milliampere or 10 nanoampere, based on its rating it will gives you. But at the same time, so you should have a higher power, like a 12 voltage with 2 ampere, 12 voltage with 5 milliampere or 1 ampere. So your driver, gate driver, should have this capability. So for that one we are using the totem pole amplifier. So this totem pole amplifier will give you the huge amount of, that is, it's a high gain configuration in amplifier component configuration, high gain current configuration. So this will give you the maximum output. Okay, it carries maximum amount of current, so that we can take we supply the gate current is the maximum current. And protections, again the zener is required to give you the one protections. And similarly you can use one more capacitance called, this is a bypass capacitor. And similarly you can use the dv by dv dt protection also. So that dv by dt protection is called, that is RCD's number. So for any kind of MOSFET you can use this configuration by using this graph, the RCD, right? So this is R C and diode. Okay, so C can be calculated with the help of this formula, and the power can be calculated. So you can use this formula to calculate this one, but it will give you a certain level of protections only. So at any point of time, the logically your circuit must be verified, then only your circuit will get work. And similarly, for to increase the turn off speed, if you keep one anti-parallel diode be after the gate circuit, then gate terminal, then we can reduce the discharge current, because this gate this resistance will stop this discharging energy discharge inside the gate to source and then gate to emitter. So if you keep on diode, then we can increase the speed control mechanisms. Then a PCB consideration. So you should have a lesser distance between the power ground to microcontroller ground, so then we can avoid some noises. And this is high frequency isolation. So this is a typical driver. So it's giving you it will work perfect any kind of circuits. So if you are using IGBT or if you are using MOSFET less than 10 ampere, it gives you perfect output. Just to take the circuit and start using in your circuit, in your application network. And again, variety of drivers, ready-made drivers also there. So high side driver, nothing but this is all. Suppose if you are involving three-phase inverter applications or in motor control applications, ready-made drivers are available. So you can use straight away. And actually from Pantech you can get individual gate driver ICs. So you can use it for any kind of applications, like a single device circuit or multi device circuit. You can use this kind of network, this kind of gate drivers. In Pantech you can get a MOSFET along gate driver, it's available. So this is a single channel with the gate driver. Similarly, two channel driver alone, it's there, it's available. And two channel MOSFET along with the gate driver. And it's a six channel gate driver, and this is the inverter model. So there is three H bridge inverter. So here is this board will help you up to 600 voltage, 10 ampere, it will give you, it will work perfect. And this again LP six driver, six numbers of drivers is in. And again, this is the 100 ampere IGBT gate driver board. So here, this is to carry up to 100, so that we have developed additional protections. So to this in this PCB. And again, SCR gate driver also available from our network. You can get it actually. And from Semikron, you can get Skyper 32R driver board. Actually, we also do some we have some stock, so you can use it. So this is absolutely fine driver for many people are using this kind of thing. So that you no need to worry about schematics error. So you can concentrate. We can mainly concentrate on the firmware development. So these are all some research. You can focus on your research on this area. So nowadays, this kind of research is getting more value. So you can implement from Pantech and get this kind of boards for your research applications. If you're interested, you can use it. And finally, we have one more trainer kit called Hybrid Solar Wind Energy Trainer Kit. So this is that wind energy trainer kit. See here, MPPT controller will be there, and then inverter module will be there. See here, we have given you the microcontroller in the outer area. So because of you can develop your own control algorithm to implement this inverter module and MPPT module. So panel voltage you can feed it, and then in a wind model voltage also you can feed it. So combinedly you can work together, and from an inverter you can do the these kind of experiments, like again about 12 experiments you can do. And here actually we have given you one more facility called if you are well versed in the MATLAB, you can develop your MATLAB code. You can directly download that MATLAB code into this board, so that also will support you, so that you can reduce your research time. And similarly, fuel cell kit. So we have a fuel cell kit from 30 wattage to 2 kilowatt. We have a fuel cell kit. So from this fuel cell, similar thing also we have. Like this is the fuel cell entire trainer kit. So the DC motor is connected to this fuel cell. So entire setup we will provide you, like hydrogen cylinder and then stack and then controller. So here you can control the motor. So from the fuel cell output, everything you can do it. So again, if you have any lab requirements or any kind of research activity, so you can get support from the Pantech. So today you are I hope you have received my entire content, and I hope I have shared my entire thoughts to you. So you may be this may be your takeaway from this today's sessions. So you know about MPPT charge controller, how to do it, and then how to integrate the grid integration, and how to develop a gate driver for this particular MOSFET or IGBT. And Pantech will help you for your lab requirements and research projects, proposals, and technical training. See, actually, our main motto is that to help the people to learn the technology in easy way. That is our main motto. So actually, so far we have trained about 6,000 participants. They have participated 30 days challenges. So actually, sir also known that event. Many people has participated on the particular event. So we conducted last 2 months back 30 days masterclass on MATLAB simulating for electrical engineering. And if you have any clarifications, you can ask me. So now I will give you the answers.
Participants, if you have any doubts, please ask. Any doubts?
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
My question is, sir, you are using only MATLAB software or any other software you are using, sir?
Actually, for research kind of thing, MATLAB we are using. Sometimes we will use a MathCAD also.
Okay, okay.
And for PCB development, all we will use Allegro software to design our layouts and all. And sometimes we will use PCB model sim, model sim for FPGA kind of activities. Yes, model sim and Xilinx. These are firmware developments. And for electrical engineering, MATLAB is the key software anywhere in the world. Right now, they have developed a lot in that industrial applications. See, for example, if instrumentation industry, like a dairy farm, so they will use a milk container, right? So they will store a milk in the big container. So they will monitor the entire parameter with the with this MATLAB itself. We can monitor all it, and similarly we can control it also. So because inside the container one boiler also will be placed, so the boiler will be controlled with the help of directly from the MATLAB. So okay. Nowadays electrical for electrical engineering, MATLAB is the key tool, sir. For okay. All electrical vehicle people using this kind of MATLAB only. In Chennai we are working project with Nissan, so they are also using MATLAB with HIL based hardware.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, regarding the solar MPPT, na? Actually, there we have explained about the boost converter. So normally, if the duty cycle is more than 0.5, the boost converter voltage will be increased more than. Whether will you get the wide control of voltage between buck converter means you can easily control from duty cycle 0 to 1 directly by range of speed control, so voltage control.
Correct.
But here input voltage will be increased more than the input voltage after duty cycle is 0.5. So any other issues will come when
sir, actually if you're talking about a boost converter, there is a thumb rule called 1:1.5. See, suppose if you are feeding 1 voltage to the boost converter, you have to boost the voltage with this topology. I'm talking about this topology, that is non-isolated topology, that is limited to 1.5 times. If you give input voltage, you can do 1 voltage, 1.5 voltage from the non-isolated boost converter topology. So to achieve this one, you can keep inductor. So based on your duty cycle, some inductor will help you to achieve this voltage on 10% or 15% or 20%. That is the capability of the energy storage device.
Okay, sir. I think, sir, thank you so much for accepting our invitation, and you were so content enough for simulation wise, and I think some of the people are new to this research area. As the content is more, maybe they cannot able to catch immediately whatever they were explaining, but really it is very much helpful for researchers as well as the students who are doing M.Tech project and all. Surely I hope you will share the PDF copy of your PPT possible. Sure. Can you share it? So sure, that I will send it to the participants also. Moreover, they will contact you if needed. Moreover, I am in the planning of contacting you. Already discussed yesterday also about our FPGA.
Yes, sir. FPGA.
Regarding here we have 3 research scholars are there in our department.
Oh, great.
So we have to take care of them also for doing some hardware. Without doing something, it is very difficult to nowadays for doctorate degree also. Value is not there. That is what we have to think about that. Anyway, I will surely contact you in future.
Fine,
already
sir.
I have contacted you for one of the DSP
processes. Yes, sir.
In the final stage, it is not materialized. I don't know what happened. Anyway, I will try my level first. Thank you so much for accepting and sir, keep in touch with us. Surely I will also contact you. Thank you so much. Thank you all participants.
Thank you.
Thank you.